here. Okay. 2.7, nonlinear inequality. So far, we've been dealing with an equal sign. And so we dealt with polynomials. That was chapter 1 and 2, right? Polynomials. And then we kind of, right at the tail end, 2.5, we start dealing with rational equations here. So now we're going to do one more thing. There it is. This is how it fits all together. So polynomial functions we'll do first. Those are easy. Rational functions, a little bit more difficult. There's an algebra way of doing it, and then there's a geometry way of doing it. We're good? So I'm going to have to kind of give you both. So kind of like keep it in your mind, those four things, right? For the polynomials, the algebra, the geometry way, rational functions, algebra, geometry way. I will say this. So how about this? AG. I know that stands for something else around here. For the polynomials, it's probably easier to do the geometry way. And for the rational functions, it's probably easier to do it the algebra way. You good? But I'm going to kind of show you both, and then you can kind of just go which one you enjoy the most. Good? Because math is enjoyment, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Better than science.
That's okay. There you go. Absolutely. So one little thing that comes up is this right here, this concept here. So if I have a graph and I have a dot here, and I have a dot down here. Question is, do I have to? And if I draw a line from one dot to the other, and I can't lift my pen off my sheet of paper, do I have to somehow, sometime cross the x-axis? Yes or no? Let's go with raising hands for yes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Raise your hands for no. It was not a tricky question. Yes, you do have to do it. So you go from here, and then you have to somehow, somewhere along the lines, you're going to have to cross. So if you go from a positive to a negative, you're going to have to somehow hit zero sometime during the process. Okay. Yes. Uh-huh.
That's just psychology.
That's regular.
It's psychology.
It's different, not reverse reverse.
Psychology is a whole different.
Oh wow, cool! I have to check it out. Okay, let's go with this one. So since you're going to hit a zero sometime, and you're going to hit a zero when there's going to be sign changes on your side, right? We're going to do this here. We're going to say, I'm going to find out when it's equal to zero, because once I know, at least I'll know these dots right here. That's what I'm looking for. So. Whoa, hold on. I can do this now. I can factor this. I need two numbers. Multiply -6, add to -1. And -3 and 2 is perfect. And so I'm going to solve for each one of these guys here. How about 3 and how about a -2? Is that good? This is the algebra of solving it.
But we want to put it on a number line.
Oh, yes. There you go. How about let's put it on a number line. Root. And I'm going to go with finding a 3 here. I could just put 0 here, just kind of range where the zeros are. But let me put a tick mark at 3, tick mark at -2. And what I'm going to do with my pen, I'm going to put a dot here. Very important. I'm going to put a dot here and dot here because it actually goes through those points. My graph goes through those points, or it actually does hit 0 there. So now the question is this. If I were to test this a little bit to the left of 0, and I'll put a little X markers here. Let me just do the problem, and then we'll come back to sort of seeing it, OK? A number that's a little bit less than -2. Anybody? -3, OK. I'm going to test -3. And I'm going to find out if it's positive or negative. That's all I care about. OK? You positive? Plug in -3. And I'm kind of almost like, I don't care about this piece here, right? I just care about the function itself. So this function itself, I'm going to plug in a -3, a -3, and see what happens. 9 + 3 - 6, positive or negative? Yeah, and I don't even care what the number is. I just positive, that's all I care, positive or negative. So this is positive. So I'm going to put a little plus sign here, plus sign, maybe 3 plus signs. Okay, I'm going to have to test a number between -2 and 3. One is cool. I'm going to go with anytime you can put a zero into stuff, put a zero. It's because zeros are so easy to work with. What's the number? negative six. I don't really care about the number. I care about the sign. So I go like this. I put a little minus signs there. And I need a number a little bit bigger than three. Four. And then a little trick here. So that's going to be 16 minus 4 minus 6. Positive or negative?
Positive.
Okay. Now, real quick here. Joe said 4. But if I were to plug in a number super big, like 10 or 100, does that kind of change? Does that kind of influence the way you're going to think of it's positive or negative? Let me just plug it in. If I plug in 100. Whoa, hold on. How about this? What's that number? It's not 94, right? It's because you got that 100 squared. Remember those big numbers that explode very quick when you square them? So now we're in 10,000. Is that positive or negative? Do we even care about what happens with the 100 and the 6? Nah, right? So sometimes it's actually easier to plug in a big number, kind of knowing what's going to happen. Okay, here's where we're at. I think we're done using this one. So if I'm looking for when this, when these variables inside this equation or inside this expression is less than zero, when are they less than zero? Perfect. In between here. So from negative 2 to 3, and that's my answer right there. Okay, this is the algebra. I'll put A for algebra. Few things that I see over here real quickly here is I see the fact that I have dots here, which means my those variables hit zero there and there. Are we good? I do see another little point is right here. Notice my inequality. I'm trying to figure out when this guy is less than zero, not less than or equal to zero. If it was less than or equal to zero, I would include -2 and 3. And I'd use what symbol would I use to include the -3 and -2 and 3? It would be a bracket, right? If I was to include it, I would go like this and like this, but that's for this symbol here. We're good. Less than or equal to, I include them. I don't include them here, so I'm good to go. Okay, the graphic way of doing it, the geometry of doing it. Let's do this here, real quick here in your mind, since you did the algebra here, is there, if I just convert this into an equation or a formula or a graph, can you guys graph that?
Yes, very slowly.
Very slowly, okay. And if you were just to factor this down a bit, can you guys graph it like this? Can you guys graph that? So let's see. Let me see if I can graph it with you guys real quick here. Ready? I have a y-intercept. What's my y-intercept here? Ooh, that goes all the way back to like chapter 2.1. That's like ancient history. Is -6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I got this little dot here. And then in factored form, just a little bit of algebra. In factored form, don't I know that this is true as well? Don't I know that this crosses at 3, crosses at -2, because those are important points. And then do I know if the parabola is going up or down? It's going up. How come? Yeah, this little guy right here, it's a positive number. That means it's going up the coefficient. So I have a graph that looks like this. Hold on. The whole thing that I'm doing here is this right here. I'm trying to figure out when is this graph now less than zero? When does it go below the x-axis? Right here. Da-da-da-da-da. And da-da-da-da-da. It goes below the x-axis from -2 to 3. Notice I'm not including the y-values. I don't care about the y-values. It's just when the graph is doing it. Good. That's what I'm looking for. When is the graph doing that? Dun-dun-dun-dun. Okay, are we jammed? Are we good with that? Does it get more complicated? Of course it gets more complicated. This is the full fun part about it. So from x squared, let's go on to x cubed. Oh, and here's what I did is I made a little graph of it here. Da-da-da. So there it is, -6, -2, -3. And I'm looking for this area right here, or this time right here that it happens. that's pretty much it for polynomials, except they get more complicated, like this one. Which? Okay, so let's go with algebra way and then geometry way. Let's see which one we like best. All right, the algebra way, we are going to set it equal to zero. Is that right? That's the whole point here. Set it equal to zero. I'm so glad that we you know, those with pins, I'm gonna do something else different here. Let's do this here. Before we put an equal sign, let's do this here. Let's add 48 first. That's gonna help us out a little bit later on with the rational one. So add this first. Let's see how this is set. Oh, sorry, forgot the 48. Got that first, good, put it down. And now I'm going to set it equal to instead of a less than symbol. All right, da-da-da, all yours now. Oh, so fun.
Is that plus 48?
Plus 48 now, uh-huh. On each side, uh-huh. I don't know.
Maybe it'll be easier to factor out x before adding 48.
Oh, gotcha. Good question. You can't factor out x if it's not set equal to zero. The only factoring you can do is when it's set equal to zero.
But what? It's still the same thing if you take out x.
Oh, sure. Let's go on just a little bit of a view of things here. If I did something like that right here, right, and I factor out this, let me do two things here. If I have something that looks like this, zero, I'll come back to this in just a second. When I factor things out, the special thing about zero is that there's only one way zero can happen, which is this has to be zero, or this guy has to be zero, right? That's really the whole premise of factoring right there. When something is set equal to a non-zero number, what happens is there's not only two answers here, there's still an infinite amount of answers, because any time I have a reciprocal between 6 1/6, that'll still give me, So any combination of that, you can say 2 or 3 here, but you could also go into fractions as well. So not gonna do the numbers themselves, but if you go like this here, that's easy. That's 3 and 2, right? Would work there. But I can also put in fractions into here, and I can use fractions to get, and once I do fractions, I could get infinite number of numbers in here. So when we factor things out, we always have it set equal to zero because of that two possibilities. It's called the zero factor property or the zero product property. All right, we have four terms here. We can do our little column thingamajiggy. Can we do our column thingamajiggy?
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah, kind of this guy here. I think we do it like this. Boom, boom. I think we go like that right here. So two, you guys are the experts on it. I'm not the expert, so you guys.
What?
Is it that right there? Or do we do it only for x squares? We can only do it for x squares or x cubes? Wow, okay.
You just need to do it.
Just takes longer.
Need to factor down cube into.
Gotcha, okay.
You only need
3 by 2? Okay. You guys teach me here because this is. So I'm going to go like this right here. Boom.
Yes.
Awesome, okay. Tell me how to do it.
Forty-eight goes in the bottom. Negative 3x
squared,
the top right and the middle left added together. So
Okay, got it. So like these two here. So negative, I'm going to put 3x squared over here so it doesn't mess with us, and negative 32x. Okay. Okay, so we're going to guess, I think we're guessing, is that right? We're going to go like get x and 2x, or x squared, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. And then 48 has a whole bunch of different factors, doesn't it? I mean, the possibilities are almost endless. You have 1 and 48, 2 and 24, 3 and 16, 4 and 12, 6. Say again? 1.5
times 32
is 1.5? How'd you get a 0.5?
Well, 1.5 times 32. Wait, are we not multiplying 32 times 48? I'm thinking of the time,
never
mind.
No, we're not.
Okay, no. I don't know. You guys are the experts on this little box thing, Majiggy.
Well, the box thing is helpful, but every once in a while, I get problems like these. You just have to stare at it for a long time.
Okay.
Eventually, it comes to you.
So I think it's still a guess. It's still a guess, though, right? You kind of plug in like, let's see, a 2 could probably work here. You assume that maybe like because these guys have to factor. You kind of maybe assume like, you know, probably a negative 4 because that will factor down some more. That's what I'm kind of just maybe guessing that maybe that would happen. And that would be 12.
Instead, it would be the square on 2x, right? If that's how we're doing it, it would be the square on the 1.3, I think.
Sorry, Elka, say it again, say again.
I think it would be the square on the 1.3 values and it would not.
Both. So I'm thinking like this here. That would be a square because this has to be a difference of two squares. Then this one, you can pull out a 2 out of this, and you get a 6, and then we could be solving something looks like this later on, and then we're going to factor that down some more. So it could be that one, could be that one. Whew, that's a toughie, guys.
Well, okay. So
I don't know
what I would think here is we know that -3x is 4, -4 plus 1. And then, so they have to be plus 5. So that is, no, not 1x, because 4 times 2x is 8x, and so -8x. So we need to be positive 5x.
Okay, positive 5x.
Because 48 is positive. Are you saying 5x there or 5x in the box?
It needs to be 5x there and.
Oh, gotcha. It's 5x in the box, yeah. Because this becomes negative 8x.
Yeah.
Because it becomes a little puzzle now, right?
Squared. There's the squared.
Yeah. So then.
Yeah, because this would be squared. Oh, then this has to be squared, right?
Because of the negative 3x squared. That the negative 8x and 5x are supposed to add up to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So then if it's 5x, it would be 5x squared.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. So like I was saying, then the square would be on 2x.
Those both have to be squared.
Yeah.
The square has to be on the 2x. That's what you were saying, like, right?
Yeah.
That makes sense. Okay. And now we got ourselves my negative 3x. Okay.
And
cool.
So it's 5x on the outside. It's 2x plus 5x.
5x goes here though for sure. Yes. Then this is negative 20x. And that's that's 12x.
But they would both need to be negative.
Yeah,
both need to be negative. Uh-huh.
Hey.
Then it does work.
Wow, that is so cool.
That was way too long.
So I got myself x minus 4. And how about a 2x squared? Plus 5x, and just make sure that it works, guys. Does it work?
Should.
Okay.
Logical.
Can we factor down some more? So this is set equal to 0. This is
set
equal. Okay. So this one is guess and check.
Plus 2. No, wait, we can't factor x minus 4. X squared, or 2x squared will be 2x. Minus 6 times x plus 2.
One second. Minus 3, okay. And we got x minus 3, x plus 4. Let's check if it works. That's 8.
The box kind of stops working as well when you get to this many terms, because when you only have a 2 by 2 box, there's not very many blank spots.
Mm-hmm.
But when you have a box this big, there's so many blank spots that what just happens.
Yeah.
So
uh-huh.
You just kind of stare
go with it, yeah,
for a while.
Uh-huh. The other way to do it, not that my way is superior, but if I were to factor this down, I would create two different parentheses, plus sign in between. So 2x cubed minus 3x squared minus 32x plus 48. And I'll deal with one parenthesis at a time. So what's the greatest thing I could pull out of that? X squared, leftovers. And then what can I pull out of this in order to make the parenthesis exactly the same? Minus 16, uh-huh. Then I'm gonna pull out the 2x minus 3 because it's one single term. And then I'm gonna factor down some more. So what this kind of allows me to do is allows me to have only binomial term afterwards. And because of that, then allows me to have the, but any which way you always go about doing it. That
yeah.
Was cool. Okay, what we got though is this right here. We got ourselves a negative, a positive 4 dot, a negative 4 dot, and what's the other dot? One and one half, right? Yeah, one and one half.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I'm gonna put it right here, one and one half or three halves. Okay. Let's save this here. So let me do something real quickly here. I'm going to do that. Oh, shucksaroo, that was not good.
Never been in those words.
But can be fixed. Voila. Okay. Are we good there? Just made some more space to work on. Okay, what we've got to do is take this guy and we're going to plug in some values a little less than negative 4. So how about a negative 5 plugged in? And let's go with a number between negative 4 and 5. So let's do this here, 1, 2, 3. Just real quick, compare answers here. So Amelia, Abby, and Elijah, can you guys plug in a negative 5? I need to know plus or minus. Elika, Violet, and Lily, can you guys plug in what, negative 1 order? Oh, no, hold on. Can we plug in a 0 in this case?
Zero.
Yeah, we plug in a 0. Just so you guys can collaborate here. Luke and Joe, a positive 2 plugged in. And Hawk and Noah, a positive 5 plugged in.
Sorry, I'm kind of confused. Where are we getting these numbers from?
Oh, sure. I'm picking numbers a little bit less than negative 4. And then I'm plugging in a number that's between negative 4 and 0, negative 4 and positive 1.5.
Okay.
Then I plug in a number between 1.5 and 4. And then I'm going to plug in a number a little bit bigger than 4. So I have to test. I know that it hits the 0 at negative 4, 1.5 and 4. I'm trying to figure out what the signs are now. Did the graph go above the x-axis or below the x-axis? That's what I'm looking for.
Nice.
Okay, and let's jam. The easy group, go ahead. 48. It's positive. Okay. Next. Any other groups there? Joe? For two, negative 12. So I got negative there. Perfect. Okay. Check with Luke. Is that what you got?
I'm so sorry. I need Joe.
Joe. Okay. Let's see. Noah, Elijah. Noah and Hawk. What'd you guys get for five? Okay. Positive?
Yes.
Cool. And back to you guys. Abby, Amelia, or Elijah?
I want it to be negative to continue.
Want it to be negative. It is negative. Okay. Okay. You guys talk to me here. So what we did is we added 48 over here. So now what we're really contemplating is this piece right here. When is the function itself greater than zero? And tell me if you guys agree. Greater than zero. So that's the reason why I made you guys keep the inequality over here.
So then it would be 0 and 5.
Let's see, when is it greater than zero? It's from -4 to +1.5. Is that right?
Yeah.
And U for union, which means there's a break in my solution set. And then at 4 or anything greater than 4. Okay. Hopefully everything's okay. Okay, -4 to 1.5. That's one piece of the solution. And then the other one is anything that's greater than 4. Are we good there, guys? We're good with that?
I'm trying to find greater than -48, not greater than 0.
Perfect, yeah. So what we did is this. Thank you for the questions here. So by adding 48 onto here, so we've changed up our problem. Instead of trying to figure out when this guy is greater than -48, by adding 48 to this guy, let me do it graphically.
We added 48 to both sides.
Yeah, because we added 48 to both sides, we didn't technically change anything, but what we did is this. We had a graph that was all the way down here. We had a graph that did this, and it was all the way over here, down about the 48 marker. And we were trying to compare when is this graph greater than -48. So we're all the way down here. And the only problem with that is we can't use this little zero property. This little zero property right here. Can't use that. That's no fun. But in order for us to be able to factor, in order for us to be able to find zeros, I have to be able to compare it to zero. So by adding 48 to both sides, what we did is we moved this graph. The whole thing, we moved it up to here. So now we have a graph that looks like that. Are we good? We didn't change the graph. We didn't change the shape of the graph. We just changed where are we comparing it. So good questions. Those are actually good, deep questions there. So now I found out, look at this. At -4 up to 1.5, it's greater than 0. And then, and then anything after 4, it's still greater than 0, which would be the exact same spots if we were comparing it all the way down at -48. Oh, my graph is wrong. Right, it would be the same exact spots there. Good question. That's a really good question about seeing the concept as opposed to just number crunching.
That was all just the algebra way, right?
Oh, that was just the algebra. With geometry, though, you do have to get to the point of having this right here. It's just you don't have to plug in values again. So, yeah, you still have to do that. You still have to do that. You still have to do that. But let's stop right here and ask yourself, look, I have 3 dots on my graph. With those 3 dots, here's my little situation. This parabola, it's a parabola that starts low, ends high. Is that right? So let me do the graph here for it. Let me do the there. That'll be easier to do here. So as we start off, this is the geometry way of doing it. By the geometry way of doing it, we still have to get down to x minus 4. Is that right? Was it 2x minus 3?
Yep.
And x plus 4 equals 0. Still had to get there to there. But the almost like the small little trick is negative 4, 1 and 1 half, positive 4. So then we go back up and say, you know, the original problem was, or the one that we scooted over, we were trying to figure out this right here. We're trying to figure out when a certain graph, which is actually degree 3, is going to be greater than 0. I have 3 points on my graph. Think back to 2.2 again. If it's a third degree polynomial, it has a positive coefficient. Do you guys remember that these guys are the ones that go like this right here? These guys are the ones that start low and end high, right? Does that have any thing recollection from 2.2?
Kind of.
Okay. So if it was a negative 2x cubed, it would be starting high, ending low, or anytime there's an odd number. If it was a negative 2x squared, that means we start low and end low, and a positive 2x squared, which means starts high and ends high. So kind of do that little formulation. It's called end behavior. So this is a positive 2x cubed and any odd number. Any odd number is going to start low and high, or start high and low. Any even number, it's either going to be low, low, or high, high. So that's kind of what we think about. So this guy starts low, ends high. Can we go through these guys?
Yeah.
You'd have to go like this, go up, come back down, turn back around to get to this guy here. When is this guy greater than 0? Right there and right there. So from negative 4 to 1 and 1 half, and anything above 4 is all good to go. Okay, the graph of it, if we were to graph it, there it is. There's my 1 and 1 half and anything above 4. And think where we're at here. Okay, so let's jam with number 3. Number 3 and number 4, is it number 3? Oh God, I got doubles of each, that's why. Okay, number 3, we've got ourselves an unusual solution set. That's the disclaimer that it has. So the question is this, when is x squared plus 2x plus 4 greater than 0? So it's compared to 0, so that's cool. So let's start doing the algebra way of doing it. We got ourselves this, and we got ourselves that now. Okay, everybody good there? Can you guys factor that? Two numbers multiplied to 4 add to 2.
2 and 2.
That'd be 2 and 2. That would make a 4 at the end. We'll make the 2 in the middle.
So wouldn't it be an I?
Oh yeah, hold on. So with x squared, that would give us we have Pythagorean theorem.
But I thought that we graphed it on a real number line.
Yeah,
so that's how we fun.
Huh, okay, so let's go. Let's go with Noah's and we'll check what Elika's thinking about here. So if we get I values in here. Okay, Elika, if we get I values in here, you know it doesn't touch the x-axis, right? Doesn't touch the real number line. So let's go with it here. How about this? Negative 2 plus or minus the square root of, hey, it was just on the video. 2 squared minus 4 times a times c all over 2 times a. And I'm only curious in this. I'm just curious in whether the inside of this little square root is going to give me a positive or a negative. That's all.
Yeah,
that's going to be 12.
16.
12. Okay, so I got myself an imaginary root, which means this guy never touches the x-axis. That's no fun. So that means my number line is just going to look like this right here. Is that right? There's never a time where I can put a dot somewhere. So the only thing I need to test is a single point. Which is the best single point to test? What do you guys say?
Zero.
Love it. Yes, I've learned. I've taught someone at least something here today. Zero. Plug in a zero into that. Positive or negative?
Positive.
That means this guy is positive all the way through from beginning to end. If it were to go into the negatives, what would have had a cross? If it was going to go into the negatives, it would have crossed zero, right? And if it crossed zero, we would have had an answer for zero. That's our little logic here. Okay. Looks like the answer is from negative infinity to positive infinity. True or false?
It's true.
True.
Yes.
Okay. What does the graph of this look like? So graphically, this is algebra. Graphically would be, isn't this a parabola that's facing, let's see, has a y-intercept at 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. It has a little dot right here, right? That's the, when I tried to factor it down, it gave me this. So I know there's no x-intercepts. But isn't this a graph that's facing up, goes up? It's an up-up graph, right? Starts high, ends high?
Yeah.
And so at this point, I have myself something that looks like this. Never touches the x-axis, it's just always up there. But when is this graph greater than zero? It's always greater than zero. Let's do this here. Based upon that right there.
So when we have an I,
I'm gonna write a letter B in here, okay.
If you have two I, is that greater than one or is that less than one?
Say it again, no.
If you have two I, is that greater than one or is that less than one? Where do we have all of that?
The thing is, once you say I, you have, it's no connection to the real number line.
Right.
Because it's a different dimension.
That's where I'm a little bit confused.
Uh-huh. So we're just using that to get us to the number line. Then we say we have no value of the number line. Hey, real quick here, that's A, right? But if I just change this up just a little bit here, what's the answer for B? We should know this right away. Answer is? When is the same graph gonna be less than zero?
Never.
Are we good there with never? All right, the way we write never is this right here. We will just put a zero with a slash through it, which means empty set. There's no numbers in this set. There's nothing here. Okay, one more of the unusual sets here. I got this one. Okay, we go there with B. So I'm going to switch the inequalities on you guys just for us to sort of see it here. So B was just the flip of the inequality to the left, less than symbol. And we got ourselves an empty set. Okay, how about this? And here's our graph right over here. Didn't touch the x-axis. Our y-intercept was 4. So therefore, we know that it stayed above all the time. This guy I'm going to change to C. That's C. Ooh, a little change there. It's going to be less than or equal to zero. So let's see what happens here. Can you guys, let's see, it's compared to zero already. Let's make it equal to zero. And can you guys factor it and find a zero for me? Ooh, okay, yeah. X plus one and another x plus one. We go to zero. Notice there's two of them, huh? We can even write it as x plus one to the second power if we wanted to, right?
Yeah.
So if we have two of the same, the condensed form of just kind of writing it like this, boom. But how many zeros do we have? Just one, huh? At negative one. I can put a dot there.
Yeah.
All right. Let's see. Anything less than negative one, you guys do, which one you guys do? Give me a number, any number, less than negative one.
Negative two.
Negative two, perfect, okay. Plug in negative two into this little guy.
Negative response, so it works.
Okay. You got yourself a negative out of it? Okay. Mm-hmm. And then anything higher than negative one?
Zero, love zero.
Okay.
Zero does not work.
Zero does not work?
Mm-hmm. Huh.
One second. Let me check. Is this?
It's one.
That'd be four, huh? Four.
No, it's supposed to be negative two, not seven parentheses as well.
Negative two, not negative two is.
That would be four minus two four. Plus one, so then that would be one.
No, oh, yeah.
It's four minus four plus one.
Four minus four, I think.
Oh, yeah, right.
Plus one. Yeah,
yeah,
so it's just a one.
It's yeah, positive. So it's still positive, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah. Yeah, still, there's my little plus, plus, plus. A zero plugged in definitely gives me a plus, plus, plus. And my answer is?
Just
the
one.
Oh, yeah. Hold on. So when is it less than or equal to zero? It's never less than zero, but there is one spot in the whole entire universe where it is exactly equal to zero, which is that one. How do we write this answer? Because it's just a one individual point, what we do is we write it like this. We write braces, and we put negative one in the brace, and then close off the brace. That means an individual piece is that one right there. So the graph of it, real quickly here, the graph of it kind of looks like this, doesn't it? It would go like, negative one is here. There's my little dot. Is that right? In fact, I even know my y-intercept. My y-intercept is positive one, right? I have a graph that goes like this. That's cool. Okay, C, I'm going to write D, E, F. We're going to do three more real quickly here. You guys tell me.
It was E. Negative infinity, negative one, and then negative
infinity for D. Perfect. Okay. Uh-huh. I'm gonna let others ponder that just for a second here. So guys, D, E, F, write down, if you don't have pens, write down what you think are the answers for D, E, F. All right, I'm going to pick on people here. Love picking on people. Amelia, Abby, or Elijah, what'd you guys get for D? When is the graph going to be less than zero? I don't know. Never less than zero, is that right? It hits the zero, right? But then it goes up again.
Can we just put the never sign?
The never sign. Let's go. Empty set sign done. Ding. Okay. Elko Violet Lily, go for it. For E, when is this graph going to be greater than or equal to zero?
I mean, it's equal to it at negative one.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's greater than zero, yes. It's equal to zero, yes. There is a point where it is that way. So both are fulfilled. Negative infinity to positive infinity, right? Sometimes we don't even put the plus sign next to positive infinity. Sometimes we do. We assume it's positive. We're good there? It works all the time. It fulfills both criteria all the time. Okay, and then guys in the back. Oh, awesome. Okay. So here's the thing. Normally, the way we write it is like this. Negative infinity to negative one, and we're going to have a break right there. And so we say all that. In other math textbooks, you could actually write it like this. You could say negative infinity to positive infinity minus that guy. That's kind of a fun little thing, but we don't normally use that notation. Okay, guys, we did not finish 2.7. We still have the rational inequalities to do. So we have finish up on Friday, review Monday, test Wednesday. You good?
So what is our problem to get into the first one? 2.6. And then I should be done with 2.7 homework on Friday, so I can check that and see on Friday.